Great pleasure for me just to welcome you to this meeting and to thank the Chronicle magazines for making this possible. This is an extraordinary topic, and it's very important to us. It's been important to us for many years. And I have to say, to talk about it, to think about it, to care about it, and it's so obvious, doesn't always happen. And to be able to create a meeting that focuses on these important areas is hard to make it happen. And not only do we not even have enough time to do all the topics properly, each presenter is lamenting that they don't have much more time to talk about the important issues that they're going to discuss. From a university perspective, I'm glad that some of our residents are here, some of our faculty in dermatology as well, and all the other people in primary care, to thank Mitch Shannon again for making this possible. So thank you very much, and I know you're going to have a successful meeting in a beautiful place on a beautiful day, and I'll turn it over to our chair. Thank you.
Bonjour à tous et bienvenue à Toronto, ladies and gentlemen and colleagues and faculty. Welcome to the first and annual Skin Spectrum Summit on Ethnodermatology. My name is Shafiq Qadri. I'm a family physician, CME lecturer, one of the medical writers for the Globe and Mail. And it's my pleasure on behalf of a whole host of individuals to welcome you to this function. I should say at the outset, I would, with your permission, Professor Scheer, like to thank you for some excellent dermatology teaching which you inflicted upon me in 1988 as a clinical clerk. I was your clinical clerk at Sunnybrook Hospital once upon a time, and I'm still executing those wonderful lessons that you gave me. So I appreciate it, and it's a privilege to share a podium with you. I'm pleased to, first of all, on our collective behalf, thank a number of individuals, the Canadian Society of Ethnodermatology, the Chronicle Group of Companies, ably represented today by Mitch Shannon, Sandra Leckie, Alan Ryan, of course, the Department of Dermatology at the University of Toronto, by courtesy of Professor Neil Scheer, Valiant Canada, Claude Barrel, if you're an Anglophone, or Claude Barret en Francais, Mary-Yves Caron, Cypher Pharmaceuticals, a number of individuals who are here, including Lynn Bulger, our colleagues from Leo Pharma, as well as Michel Lavoie of Dermtech Pharmaceutique. So thank you for your support, your encouragement, for replying to all those emails and phone calls and faxes. And we not only look forward to hosting this as an annual event, but I'm pleased to say there's such interest that we're likely going to expand to Toronto, Vancouver, as well as Montreal on an annual basis. Of course, social media being what it is, please follow us, not only leave us your emails, because we'd like to stay engaged with you during the course of the year to not only plan programs, but to learn and tweak and improve so that we can bring to you materials and programming and speakers and the academics that will help us serve our patients in a better capacity. Please follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/skinspectrum15, as well as, I should mention, edited highlights of these programs will be featured, meaning the video and audio, on www.skinspectrum.ca. As well, the Chronicle Group of Companies is looking to publish a supplement, whether it's paper-based or digital or possibly a book of some of the findings and recommendations and pearls of wisdom, which no doubt will come at you from this podium. I would also respectfully invite you to please fill out these evaluation forms, which are in your packages. I'm told that dessert will not be served unless this is properly completed, and as well, accreditation is currently under review by the various powers that be. So with that, as I mentioned at the outset, I'm a family physician, and I think, if I may just make a comment generally, first of all, skin spectrum and ethnodermatology, or skin of color, as some of our American colleagues will use in their phrases. We used to talk about visible minorities, but it seems to be that slowly but surely, in certainly various parts of Ontario and Toronto and Canada, we are actually talking about visible majorities. And of course, that changes the landscape of many, many things. And we know whether we're talking about, for example, family history, which is perhaps a proxy for ethnicity, that all of these things impact perhaps the full array, the full matrix of medical issues, and of particularly, of course, dermatological illnesses. I should also mention that with due respect to kind of the various faculties, and of course that things are changing and improving decade by decade, I think those of us who are out and have been out for several years and decades or so in primary care seem to sense that there's a bit of a disconnect between the clear and present urgency and frequency and number of patients who come our way with some form of dermatological complaint, whether it's primary or it's secondary or it's a side effect of medication or a manifestation of allergies or a drug side effect, etc., and the amount of teaching that's perhaps devoted to dermatology and dermatological illnesses in many, many different faculties. So I think efforts such as these, especially when there's a synergy between so many different groups, whether it's the departments of dermatology at the University of Toronto. We have, by the way, a very stellar faculty for you. As you'll see, each of them are the types of individuals that you would probably like to spend an entire day or by the way, entire week shadowing and in preceptorships, because I think it's you'll see as the day unfolds that there's an extraordinary breadth, range, technological enablement, and also deep contribution to the field and advancing the science. It's now my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, who is Dr. Jaggi Rao, who is a board-certified dermatologist not only in Canada, but also the United States. He's a cosmetic surgeon, originally hailing here from the University of Toronto, having completed his MD here, as well as trained at McMaster, and board-certified in cosmetic surgery in Southern California. He is currently a full professor of medicine and serves as the program director for the dermatology residency training program at the University of Alberta. He's an extraordinarily prolific writer and investigator and teacher. I think this is lecture number 505 and counting. I should also mention he's done some extraordinary work, and no doubt we'll perhaps hear about that, in the enablement of technology and sort of teledermatology, if I can call it that, and I'm sure we'll hear a little bit about that. Maintenant, j'ai le plaisir de présenter un collègue dermatologue, Dr. Jaggi Rao.
Thanks so much, Dr. Kadri. Fantastic intro. I wish my mom was here. So, make sure I get our bearings here. Okay. Can everybody hear me okay? Thank you. I'd like to thank Dr. Scheer, Mitch Shannon, Dr. Kadri, and the committee for inviting me to come and speak. My name is Jaggi Rao. As mentioned, I'm a dermatologist in Edmonton, where we actually have more than three people there. Out of the three people we have, two of them are probably ethnic, and I think that's true for the rest of Canada. For myself, I see a lot of patients with ethnic skin, largely because that I myself am ethnic, and people feel that I must have some type of expertise. And you know, it kind of came along that way. I'm primarily a laser surgeon, so that's the topic for today, laser therapy for ethnic skin. It is quite challenging in many cases to treat skin of color, as we call it in the US, but there are some tips that I can share with you. This is quite a difficult presentation for me to do, largely because it's such a broad topic, and to compile that into 20 minutes or 30 minutes, it doesn't really quite do it justice, but we're going to touch on some salient points. Hopefully you'll enjoy it. So does anybody know what movie this is? Oh, that's good. That's very, very good. So usually people, when they see something like this, they think, oh, this good movie, a lot of action. What I like about this movie is this. This is the first time that a laser was shown on the silver screen. Unfortunately, it was used as a weapon, and sometimes people do use it as a weapon when they're performing laser dermatology. But we're going to show you some tips so that it doesn't become a weapon, becomes a very nice therapeutic tool. But to my knowledge, it was the first time that it was ever used on the silver screen. Okay. Let's divide the presentation up into three components. The first would be an ethnic skin overview. Just talks a little bit about ethnic skin as it pertains to laser dermatology. Two, I'm going to talk about laser tissue interaction. And then finally, we're just going to go into some different examples of how we can treat the skin and the multiple problems that happen. This is our favorite organ. This is the anatomy of everyone's skin. Now, if you took a cross-section of the skin and you didn't stain it, everybody's skin would look very similar to this. There'd be some subtle differences, but more or less the structures would be there and they'd be in this order. You have the epidermis, the dermis, and the subcutaneous fat. There's all these different things going on, different structures, lots of functioning going on. But you don't really see a difference if you look at the cross-section between light skin versus dark skin. You'd have to do some special stains. However, there is a difference if you take a look microstructurally. Does anybody know what we're seeing here? Yeah, this is the melanocyte. And so the melanocyte is that organelle that cell that's responsible for our pigmentation. And I just wanted to point out a couple of things that you should know. The melanocyte is surrounded by these keratinocytes. They say the number ranges from 6 to 25. Keratinocytes for every melanocyte that's there. And that's true regardless of whether you're dark or fair-skinned. And you see these little packets. These are melanosomes. So we know that the melanocytes are the melanin-generating cell, and they actually generate the melanin, and they package it into these little organelles called melanosomes. And the melanosomes, they tend to travel throughout the melanocyte through these dendrites that we see. So as we know, the melanocyte is derived from neuroectodermal origin. It looks very similar to a nerve cell in that regard. It has these little finger-like projections, and you have these melanosomes that go through these dendrites and ultimately transfer to other keratinocytes. So we're going to talk a little bit about that in a bit more detail. The Fitzpatrick skin phototype is also very important when we're talking about skin of color, and particularly as it pertains to laser treatment. We know on the far left we have patients who are skin types 1, 2, and 3, so generally the fair skin types, and they tend to burn more than tan. And as you move towards the right, we go into skin types 4, 5, and 6, 6 being black skin, and 4 and 5 a little bit less dark, but certainly one that would tan. So before we begin anything, I would just want to talk about some of the biological distinctions. There are some key differences between darkly pigmented skin versus lighter skin. And we can actually talk about the contributions, the differences being related to the different diseases that we see. And we're going to talk about some of those skin diseases in this talk and many more after this talk. And also it really pertains to the safety of the laser procedures that we'll discuss. So what are these distinctions? Well, I like to divide it up into structural and then functional. So structural distinctions between light versus dark skin include increased epidermal melanin. So we see that, of course, in darker skin types. And why is that the case? Well, if we take a look ultrastructurally, we'll see that the melanosomes in darker skin people, they exhibit increased size. So compared to their lighter skin counterparts, they're larger. They're also singly dispersed. And they're also widely distributed within the keratinocytes as well as the melanocytes. But we're talking more of the keratinocytes. They're just widely distributed through there, and that's what gives the color. Also, not so much pertinent to the skin itself, but we'll notice that often skin in darker skin types, or the hair in darker skin types is often thicker. It tends to curl, and that'll play a role, especially when we talk about some of the other conditions. Pseudofolliculitis and so forth. Now, functional distinctions compared to lightly pigmented groups, the darker skin types demonstrate these three things. One is labile melanocyte responses, two is reactive fibroblasts, and three is increased sebaceous gland activity. So with the first one, labile melanocyte responses, when that happens, this is why we have an increased prevalence of pigmentary disorders. Melasma is more common in darker skin types. We have post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation that happens. And often this can also be seen after a procedure, not just laser procedures, but almost any procedure that occurs with the skin. With regards to reactive fibroblasts, if you have fibroblasts that are too reactive, then there's higher prevalence of collagen deposition. If it overproduces, then you have keloidal or hypertrophic scarring. The increased sebaceous gland activity comes into play with laser treatment because it creates a variability in heat absorption. So if you're treating somebody who has very oily skin versus somebody who has dry skin, there will be some degree of variability, and sometimes you have to take that into consideration as well. Often we'll even dry out their skin prior to doing a laser treatment, such as laser resurfacing. We can see some difference. I know that Dr. Alexa is going to be discussing this a little bit more detail, but just to touch upon this, both of these patients are exactly the same age, and they both have ethnic skin. But you'll notice the patient on the left is lighter skin compared to the person on the right. And what do you notice is more textural differences on the person on the left with the lighter skin versus more color differences with the patient on the right. The patient on the left, although the same age, has more fine lines, more wrinkles. There's some solar elastosis that's there. And there's a little bit of pigmentary change as well. But we're seeing a lot of lentigines on the right. We're seeing melasma. We're seeing a lot more pigmentary changes with a patient who has a bit more darker skin. Let's talk a little bit about laser basics. So before we get into laser and to discuss how laser interacts with skin tissue, particularly ethnic skin, we need to know what is laser. Now, laser isn't a device, as we say. We commonly call it a device, this laser pointer. We saw James Bond in the Goldfinger movie. We call that a laser. But don't think of it as a device. Think of it as a process. And the process is an acronym. It stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So that's the acronym for the process that's occurring. It's not a natural process, it's man-made. So you won't find laser-type lights anywhere in the universe naturally. It has to be created. And here we have a laser device that's creating this laser beam. And this is a schematic of what a laser is now, beyond the scope of this presentation. But if you have, in order to create a laser device that would produce laser light, it's actually not that easy. A couple of things that you definitely would need to have. I'll just show you over here. One is you need to have a container. You need to have an active medium. An active medium can be a solid, liquid, or gas. And it has to have the ability to have excitation of electrons. And almost anything can laser in the right context. You need to have a mirror on one side and then another mirror on the other side. And you need to have an energy source. We call that an excitation mechanism. When you have electrons that are coming into this container, what happens is they'll go back and forth by this mirror, and then when they reach a certain excitation state, they'll actually come out through this mirror on this side as a laser beam. And we can see the schematic there, and a real example. Now, it accidentally turned off. Can we turn that back on? Same button? Okay, perfect. So what makes laser light a little bit different from other forms of light energy are the three properties. Laser light, you can see on the top diagrams here. I want to turn it off again. This is all laser light, and this is all non-laser light. So laser light demonstrates these particular properties. One is it's collimated. What that means is that it goes in a straight beam, and it doesn't really diverge. So it doesn't converge, it doesn't diverge, it just goes straight. And we utilize that all the time. In fact, this laser pointer is probably the best example of that. If I shot it very close to me, you'd see that the diameter would be about maybe 4 or 6 millimeters in diameter, that little spot. If I shot it across the room, it would be the same. If I shot at the CN Tower, it would probably be the same. It's very little divergence with that, and we call that collimation. The second is monochromaticity. All laser light has the same color. And that means it always has the same output wavelength. In this case, the laser I'm holding is green. It's probably 532 nanometers. It's not 533, it's not 531, it's exactly 532. And that's very different from white light, which if we know that it diverges. And we also know that if we push white light through a spectrum, through a prism, it turns into a spectrum of light. So it actually has a broad range of light. Third and final property of laser light is that laser light is coherent. That's what we call a defined phase relation. So we know that light travels in waves, and all the waves in laser light tend to meet each other. So the crests meet the crests, and the troughs meet the troughs. That gives it a certain amount of energy to travel great distances. This laser pointer could probably go about 10 kilometers, which is amazing. There's no way that our incandescent lights, maybe the projector light or even any type of light that we're seeing that's not a laser light will only go a certain distance and then it will fade itself out. And that's because you don't have that coherency. So those things are very important when we're talking about laser science. Now let's talk about laser tissue effects. I've listed the three ways that laser light can interact with the human skin. The first is photothermal, the second is photoacoustic, and the third is called photobiostimulation. To my knowledge, this is the only three ways that light can interact with skin tissue.
Photothermal is by far the most common way that we treat the skin. So most of the lasers that we'll be discussing today operate under the photothermal concept. And that includes vascular lasers, pigment lasers, laser hair removal, the resurfacing lasers, both ablative, which means vaporizing lasers, as well as the non-ablative or subablative lasers. They operate with heat. And then finally, intense pulse light, which isn't technically a laser, it's just a very powerful light source. It also operates utilizing heat. Photoacoustic is very different. The classic example is tattoo removal lasers. They may produce heat, but that's not primarily how they work. With tattoo removal lasers, what happens is the pulsed light that enters the skin is pulsing at such a very high frequency and such a short pulse duration, rather than milliseconds, and it's in the order of nanoseconds or even picoseconds. When you do that, that causes a shock wave that occurs, and that shock wave disturbs the local environment of the skin. Usually it stimulates the immune system, so it takes pigment away. That's typically how laser tattoo removal works. Then finally, we have photobiostimulation. Examples of that include photodynamic therapy, or PDT. Excimer laser works in that concept, so it helps to stimulate some of the chemical processes in the skin, including melanogenesis. And also laser hair stimulation. So we're going to talk mostly about thermal lasers for the remainder of this discussion, and how do thermal lasers work. I've written it on the left here, but I'm just going to demonstrate this for you by actual laser light. We have a diagrammatic representation of the skin on the left. And you can see the light is coming from the left. And as it hits the skin, actually a lot of that light will be reflected. And that's not true just for lasers. It's true for any type of light that's hitting the skin. Most of it is actually reflected, and a little bit goes through. A little bit that goes through, the remainder is scattered. And some of it will hit the target. Some of it will actually go through the target. We call that transmission. And what we really want with laser therapy is absorption. So there's actually very little amount of regular light that gets absorbed by the target. And that target tissue target could be a hair follicle, a blood vessel, it could be a molecule of water, it could be literally anything. This whole concept of having light that's absorbed by a very specific target is called selective photothermolysis. If we have too much energy that's going to be released to the surrounding tissue, a lot of bad things can happen. We don't want that. We want to have selective targeting of only the target in question, and only we want that light to be converted into heat, and ultimately we want to either destroy the target or impair that target. So here are the three major targets in the skin. We call them chromophores because they're light-absorbing compounds. One of them is melanin, which we know, and melanin is not only within epidermal cells, it's also within hair follicles, and it also might be within the dermis too. Hemoglobin is a second chromophore in the skin. It's a major chromophore that's within vessels, and specifically within red blood cells. And then finally, we have water. And water is throughout the skin, not only in the epidermis, but also in the dermis. This is the target when we're talking about laser resurfacing, when we're talking about bulk heating, new collagenesis, new collagen production. It all has to do with water. So if you take a look at, again, a diagrammatic representation of the skin, you see how busy the dermis is, and the epidermis is actually quite busy as well. How is it that we can target just one component of this, but leaving everything else the same? And that's really what laser tissue science is all about. So you can see it's quite busy. We have blood vessels, we have nerves that are there, we have pigment, we have hair follicles, we have a lot of cells. In order to target just one of those particular tissue types is the challenge with laser treatment. And if you don't meet the challenge, this is something that you might get. So this is too much collateral heating. In this case, a patient was treated for intense pulse light intense pulse light therapy for a little bit of brown spots that were on the skin, some lentigines or freckles, and unfortunately there was too much heat that was released to the surrounding tissue, and this is often what you're left with, is a burn. Now initially it might be hyperpigmented, but often later it becomes hypo or depigmented, and it's a challenge to treat that after. So let's talk briefly about the different parameters that we need to know in order to minimize damage and to have effective laser treatment. I like to divide those parameters up into inherent parameters. These are parameters within the laser itself, within the light. And then we have adjunctive parameters. These are the inherent parameters: wavelength, spot size, pulse duration, and fluence. And the adjunctive parameters are cooling and pulse delivery, which include the frequency at which the pulse is delivered, as well as a concept called pulse stacking. I'm just going to go really briefly into this before we get into the actual conditions themselves. First, let's talk a little bit about wavelength. So wavelength is probably the most important factor, or at least the first factor that we think about when we're treating somebody for a skin problem with laser. So this, what you're seeing here, this diagram is the absorption spectra for melanin, but also for hemoglobin. The melanin in here, the line is designated by the brown. So this is melanin, and then the hemoglobin has a little bit of a fancier line. It has a double peaks, and then it comes down, and then it comes up again, and you can see it's a little bit more interesting. The y-axis is absorption, and the x-axis is wavelength. So you can see as you move along the visible spectrum, which is 400 nanometers to 800 nanometers, the two different chromophores, melanin and hemoglobin, will absorb light in a little bit of a different way. Now, in order to achieve proper selective photothermolysis, that is, we want a target to be destroyed but leave less collateral damage, we have to choose very specific lasers to do that. And I've listed all the lasers that we use for both vascular and pigmentary problems at the bottom here. So this is an example. If we wanted to treat pigment, let's say hair removal, if you wanted to do laser hair removal, which we know the target chromophore is melanin, really the lasers that we want to use are in this area. So they would include the ruby laser, the alexandrite laser, and the 810 nanometer diode laser. The reason for that is that there's a trough with vasculature at this point, right? So you see the hemoglobin curve, it doesn't absorb a lot, but we do have pretty good, decent absorption with the melanin curve. So this would be the pigmented lasers right here. Now, if we wanted to treat blood vessels, and let's say they were superficial, these two lasers would be very good. Why? Because they correspond to the first primary and secondary peak of hemoglobin absorption. So that's why we often will use a KTP laser, 532 nanometer laser. In fact, so is this green laser pointer that I'm having. It's just not powerful enough to go through the skin. But if it was, what it would do, it would selectively be absorbed by hemoglobin as opposed to melanin, and you get absorption, heating, and hopefully destruction of our target. There is another minor peak, which is, go back, which is right here. So this peak is at approximately 1064 nanometers, and the laser that we use at that point, and we'll be talking a lot about that, is called the 1064 nanometer ND-YAG laser. And it also competes with melanin. This is a very important wavelength because we use that a lot for hair removal in darker skin individuals. We'll discuss that in a minute. This is the absorption spectrum for water. And we'll notice it doesn't start in the visible spectrum, it starts in the near infrared spectrum, right with approximately 1,000 nanometers, and then it goes further, even beyond the screen, up to 10,600 nanometers. Now, we can divide this up into near-infrared versus far-infrared, and what's happening here is if light from a laser, now this will be all invisible light, we wouldn't be able to see it, but if it goes onto the skin and it hits the skin, anything on the left, any of these points here, will heat up the tissue, but it won't be hot enough to vaporize the tissue. Anything that's on this side, 2700 or more, if it's providing you have the right energy, will not only heat it up, but it'll vaporize tissue. The temperature of the tissue will reach over 100 degrees Celsius, and literally you'll have vaporization or sublimation, as we call it. And let's put some of the lasers there. So these are the wavelengths and lasers that are involved for non-ablative resurfacing. And for resurfacing that's ablative or vaporized resurfacing, there's three lasers that are on the market. The traditional one has been the carbon dioxide laser. That was the first one that was ever made. It has an operational wavelength of 10,600 nanometers. And then we have the erbium YAG wavelength, which is up here, and that's at 2940 nanometers. And then we have one that's kind of in the middle here between the two lasers at with regards to absorption at 2790, and that's called a YSGG laser, yttrium, scandium, gallium, garnet. The two lasers that I really want you to focus on are the carbon dioxide laser and the erbium YAG laser. The erbium YAG is the one that we use particularly for darker skin. And the reason for that is that if you have light from the erbium YAG laser and it hits the skin, most, if not all of that, is going to go directly to the target and cause vaporization of the target with very little collateral damage. You're not going to have a lot of heat that's surrounding that tissue. All of that's going to be going into vaporization, and that's really what we want to do when we're treating darker skin types. The other thing to remember is that wavelength is also important for penetration depth, at least when we're talking about visible lasers. So you can see here from 532 nanometers, 532 nanometers way up here to the ND-YAG laser 1064, the longer our wavelength, the greater our depth of penetration into the skin. So we mentioned that there's a couple of vascular lasers, the 532, the 585 nanometer laser. If we compare the depth of penetration here for those lasers compared to the 1064 nanometer laser can actually penetrate four times the depth and also capture blood vessels. That's why it's very important if you have a patient who has deeper blood vessels, we would use the 1064 nanometer ND-YAG laser. Okay, just going along spot size. So just basically, the larger the spot size, the deeper the target you can reach. If you have a small spot size, most of that energy is going to be refracted, reflected, and scattered. You're not really going to reach your target. For pulse duration, this is very important. The thing to remember is that small objects get hotter faster, and they also lose their temperature very quickly as well compared to larger objects. The nail on the left will get hotter quicker, and it'll very quickly lose its energy to the surrounding tissue compared to the spike on the right. And so that's really what pulse duration is. Initially, when lasers came about, there was no such thing as pulse durations. They were either on or they were off. And now, by pulsing it, we can create a certain degree of safety. And that's very important when we're targeting specific tissue. These are the common pulse durations that we'd see with organelles in the skin. So microvasculature, small capillary loops, because they're small objects, we don't need a large pulse duration. We're talking 0.3 of a millisecond. Telangiectasia is a little bit longer, 10 to 20 milliseconds. Reticular veins, 40 to 60 milliseconds. Same thing with hair follicles. And if you really wanted to get deep in the skin and we want to cause some tissue plumping, you need to hold the temperature steady for about 3 to 5 seconds. Very minimally. So you can see that the deeper you go and the larger the organelle, the longer the pulse duration should be. Now for ethnic skin, if you use parallel cooling, the longer the pulse duration, generally speaking, the safer it will be for the epidermis. So if we're doing laser hair removal, for example, we would want to use very long pulse durations. Not uncommon to use 40, 60, 80, or even 100 milliseconds when we're treating laser hair removal. There's no such thing as a too long pulse duration. The only problem with it is it won't be as powerful, so it might take several sessions to achieve our goal. Finally, fluence. So fluence is just the energy level that the laser beam is hitting the skin. It's measured in joules per centimeter squared. And then we'll just talk briefly about some of these other inherent, these adjunctive parameters. So cooling is extremely important when talking about ethnic skin treatment. There's three ways of cooling the skin. One is contact cooling, and that can either be by ice, it can be by a cold tip that's put onto the skin, or it could even be by some other device that's put onto the skin, for example, a sapphire crystal. Forced air. So we see an example of that with this thermograph. So what's happening here is the blue. This is all cold temperature. That's by constant cold air versus not using it on a lesion next to this one. And you can see the temperature actually goes up quite a bit. And then there's cryogen sprays. So these will use anything from ethyl chloride. We really don't use liquid nitrogen. That's way too cold. But ethyl chloride is a typical cryogen that's used in most laser systems. And here it's spraying on the skin both before and after the laser pulse. And the goals for this, safety as well as comfort. So overall, this is a take-home slide. These are the parameter suggestions for ethnic skin. For wavelength, you have to always consider your chromophore. The risk of melanin absorption is very high, depending on the wavelength that you're doing. And you want to use a longer wavelength if you're treating the epidermis. Use settings that will minimize the extent of your epidermal injury. So be more conservative than lighter skin types. Lower fluences, longer pulse durations. You want to use low densities, especially if you're talking about fractional resurfacing. You have to consider pre and post treatment, sun protection, lightening regimens. Sometimes we'll even use topical steroids to help to reduce post-inflammatory pigmentation. And most importantly, judicious epidermal cooling. So slower treatments, we'll often pause between passes. We'll use cooling both before, during, and after treatment. And if you do that, you'll probably have some good success. Just running out of time, but very briefly, just some laser applications. These are all the lasers, to my knowledge, that are used in dermatology. And you can see they're quite large. The new lasers that happen can usually fit into one of these categories. So these are the big cubby holes for laser treatment. The ones that are